There exists a threat from anti-hunting groups to politicians trying to give our land away, and we won't stand for it. Those vast western landscapes provide the space for our wildlife to thrive and a place for hunters and anglers to fuel the fire that sparks their soul. In this show, we share our love of hunting, fishing, and conservation. Here, we provide the foundation to meet these threats through passion and the grit of the American outdoorsman. Welcome to the Western Huntsman Podcast. All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this episode of the Western Huntsman Podcast. This is Jim Huntsman, your host, coming at you from the Broken Town Studio right here in Clark Fork, Idaho. I got a hell of a show for you guys this week. I'm really excited about this one. If you guys remember a while back, we had Mike Edgehouse on talking meat, and this kind of led me to a lot more questions down this path. And on this episode, I've got a Dr. Phil Bass, University of Idaho, who is a bona fide meat scientist. And one of the things I like when we're emailing back and forth is at the bottom of your email signature, it says, go beef. And so I appreciate you coming on the show. How you doing?
I'm excited to be here. Yes, I am a meat enthusiast, and beef is my medium in which I work predominantly. But yeah,
fantastic, man. Yep. So before I want to get into your background and we talk about your podcast a little bit, but sure. Do you prefer Dr. Bass, Dr. Phil, or Phil, or how should I address you?
Master and commander would be fine.
Master, but, I like your style.
Phil is just fine. Yep.
Okay. Okay. So why don't you kick us off with a little bit of background on you and tell us what you do, and then tell us about your podcast too, man.
Yeah. So the short of it right now is that I've been with the University of Idaho for 5 years. Prior to that, I was in industry. I was with the Certified Angus Beef brand out in Ohio for 8.5 years, 8.5 glorious years. In fact, it was fantastic, but it was time to move back west. My wife and I are both Westerners, and I grew up in a very Italian family. My last name is not Italian by any stretch, but I grew up in a very Italian family, and we harvested our own animals, cut our own meat, made our own sausages, salamis, and everything. And so it's been in my DNA to be a meathead, so to say. And so love it.
Yeah, I'm always curious, like with something like meat science, what were you in high school and you thought, you know what, my goal, my dream is I'm going to go pursue a degree in meat and become this professor of meat and a scientist. Well, how does that come about?
And I'm glad you asked that. I have a feeling if any of our other fellow meatheads out there hear this, they'll probably have a similar story to tell. But I didn't know meat science was a thing until I got to the university setting. I just was excited to go cut meat at the meat lab, the USDA inspected meat lab on campus at Cal Poly in San Luis Obispo, California. Learn the trade from an excellent meat cutter, Dr. Rudy Wooten, and it just blossomed from there. Dr. Bob Delmore is who I did my master's degree under. Again, an industry professional moved back into the academic world, and it's a trait. I've always had an absolute passion for cutting meat and making sausages and things like that. And found out that it is a career opportunity. I originally wanted to be a high school ag teacher. But I quickly found out that there's no way I could teach high school. But I did love the teaching component. And to do that, you had to get a PhD. And I continued on meat science. And here I am at the university level.
So. What'd you do your PhD on? Was it
It was beef quality and fabrication. Quality? Yeah.
Oh, cool.
We have some very, very intelligent folks in the meat sciences. I am not one of them. I am just a kill it and weigh it kind of meat scientist. If I, if I write up a research project, it's because I have selfish reasons that I want to go pick up a knife and do a little meat cutting. And so I'm a very applied meat scientist in that regard, but studied under some very, very intelligent folks nonetheless.
Well, obviously you're pretty passionate about it because you do what you do for a living, mm-hmm. down in Moscow, Idaho, which is a beautiful area. Yep. And the other side of it is you do a podcast, and that's it's right. called MeatPad, or wait, I said it wrong.
It's a funny one. MeatsPad.
MeatsPad.
MeatsPad. Yeah. I'm so fortunate to have, I was interviewed by Francisco Nahar, and who is now Dr. Francisco Nahar. And Francisco, when he was wrapping up his PhD at Kansas State University, he started this podcast in 2020. It was a time that everyone was looking for information and had all kinds of time on their hands. And
right.
so he looked at it as to focus on our small to medium sized meat processors, folks that process game quite readily. Just trying to get the science information out there. And so we take sometimes some rather complicated subjects and boil it down to Reader's Digest format of meat science topics. And it varies from everything from, humane studying of pigs to food safety to color quality and tenderness and everything in between. It's a lot of fun. If folks have any interest, just look up MeatsPad. It's kind of a funny little name for it, but think of Notepad, but meat. So
yeah, and it's full of I can't believe the amount of information. And it's funny, when I reached out to you, I didn't know that you were one of the hosts on that show, because I told you I've listened to that, and because I geek out on this stuff. And so I'm far from a scientist, but it's really good for what I do as a hunter. Uh-huh. To understand this side of it. And because the meat is, that's the end game. That's the goal. Yeah. And that's how, yeah. Yeah. And I want to kind of set the conversation up along those lines. You know, there's a couple of different ways or a couple of different types of hunters. Some hunters, they go out and it's kind of a pastime for them. And maybe they get a deer or an elk or something like that every few years and whatnot. And then you have guys or gals that take it to a little bit more of an extreme level, like me, where our goal is to not, with the exception of if we want a really good ribeye, we want to go to the grocery store and grab one, right? Or go out to dinner. But 95% of the meat we eat here at home is wild game. Yeah. That's why I think it's of interest to me to talk to you, and I think I could learn a lot from you. And I know if I'm learning a lot from you, I know there's going to be a lot of listeners that are going to learn a lot from you. And so this is going to be cool, man. I appreciate it. Can you give me like a bird's eye view of how you feel a discussion with a meat scientist and somebody who kind of specializes in beef with all the years of experience and schooling you've had on it, what your philosophy in terms of how that would apply to wild game? Mm-hmm. Does that make sense how I'm asking that? And I'm all tangled up in my mic cord here. But there we go.
So beef does apply very closely to many of our wild game quadrupeds. In fact, their digestive systems are going to be practically identical in the case of deer and elk and antelope and things like that. Those are ruminant type animals. So they're going to generate similar types of fat. Granted, the flavors will be different. And where that, how that fat's distributed is just, we have nature that is taking care of things nearly 100% and managing the genetics in the game side of things. Whereas beef, we've been raising these animals domestically for thousands of years. And so we really have narrowed down into what it is that we desire as consumers, as people eating meat. Mm-hmm. And so the fat depositions are going to be a little bit different, but really when it comes down to how the muscle itself is operating, it's going to be very, very similar. Beef cattle have a tendency to, we put them out on range. That's what we do. There's a lot of misinformation out there. We just lock them up and we feed them grain from day one. Well, no, that's too expensive. First off, if you want to just go with practical sense.
Yeah.
Beef are amazing creatures that we can put out on range land. And in fact, in a lot of public lands, similar to where hunters are out there harvesting deer and elk and such, because those animals eat similar things. They can eat the grass and the shrubbery and the low-lying trees and leaves and things like that, but they can grow on that. And that's pretty cool. What they do with that nutrients at a younger age is they're building muscle and they're building bone. And that muscle is going to be very similar to our game in the respect that it's a red color. It's a dark red color to it. Mm-hmm. And the contrast would be, say, pork and poultry at a grocery store. It's going to be a very light pink color. What that means is it's a different muscle fiber type. And I'm not going to get into all the muscle fiber types. And in fact, if you check out our podcast with Dr. Amanda McKeith, we talk about
yes
fiber types to get really yes. nerded out on that
super stuff. Interesting yeah. one too yeah
but back to the whole idea of kind of crossover between beef and lamb and goat and then our game species is you know, we do have to recognize the fact that that darker meat is going to have a little bit more robust flavor to it, and it's going to age different than the lighter color species, our domesticated pork and poultry. We can put some additional age on those animals that we harvest. And when I say age, it's post-mortem. After you harvest the animal, you let it hang in refrigerated environments. And that's going to enhance tenderness. And I think a lot of experienced hunters are familiar with this. But
I think so. Yeah. I think one question that automatically pops into my mind when you say that is temperature. When you say refrigerated, let's say we're hunting in mid-October and we're hitting 65 during the day, but dropping down to 38 at night.
Yeah.
Is that bad? Is that good? Is it irrelevant? Can you speak to that for a minute?
Oh man. Well, we only have an hour, right? No, I know. Right, I know. So no, that's a really great question. Temperature means a lot when it comes to aging product. For food safety and quality reasons, I always will recommend get that thing in refrigeration or get it under 40 degrees as quickly as you can, realistically speaking, knowing that you may be out in the backcountry and it's going to take a while before you're there. Mm-hmm. But getting that heat out of the carcass is critical for to prevent spoilage and for food safety concerns. Okay, so get all the microbiology stuff out of the way.
Okay,
down to what's happening at the muscle level. The warmer that muscle is, the faster the enzymes are going to operate. And the enzymes are the natural enzymes that's in the muscle. They're in you and I right now, mm-hmm. constantly turning over protein. But when we harvest the animal, now we can't rebuild the protein anymore. But those enzymes are still active. And they're going to break down the protein. And they're going to make the meat more tender. But I don't necessarily recommend aging at 65 degrees, like you said. Getting into refrigeration. And within 7 to 14 days of refrigeration, you're going to really optimize that tenderness of most of our wild game species. And when I say refrigeration again, 40 degrees is the magic number that I will put out as a meat scientist. I know some guys maybe have home refrigeration systems. Do the best you can. You know, just keep it as cold as you can without freezing it.
Okay. So that's what I was going to ask. So 40 degrees is better than, say, 35? Let's say you have a refrigeration system at home and you could set it. In your case, you would say 40 over like 35.
Honestly, I would be somewhere in between there. This is a great question. So if you have a really robust refrigeration system at home and you can really tune in the temperature, 36 to 38 is
okay.
kind of the ideal range. The closer you get to 40, the closer you get to the danger zone of pathogenic microbes. So our bacteria that can make you sick.
Mm-hmm.
We want to stay away from that stuff. And so under 40 degrees, and you're very safe in that particular in that case. If you're going below 35, you're slowing the enzymes. Now we're talking biochemistry, right?
Uh-huh.
So you're actually slowing the enzymes down to a point where they're not doing as much as they could. And so you're not going to get the tenderness that you want, that you would have gotten if the meat was just a little bit warmer. And it's amazing how those subtle differences in just a few degrees Fahrenheit can make a big difference.
Yeah.
Yeah. Somewhere in the 36, 38. Oh, man, that's the sweet spot right there.
Okay. That's good to know. That's good to know, because I did notice last year, my daughters are now hunters, and they're better at it than I am. In fact, awesome. There was a huge difference in temperature of hanging one of my girls' bucks versus hanging the other buck. And we could tell when we cook it, there is a difference. My older daughter's buck tastes a lot better. Okay. So, and I think that's what it was, is I allowed my younger daughter's buck, to hang in some warmer temperatures, mm-hmm. where, and maybe you can explain that, but you know how I've got it hung, I've got it in a meat bag. And, mm-hmm. and so when I take it out and we do all our own butchering and everything. And I'm probably like, guys like you would just absolutely roll their eyes in the way we do it.
No, but, no.
it's got that outer layer, uh-huh. that even starts changing color, and then you start cutting that meat open, and it's a lot more red. It's a lot more tender on the inside, right?
Yes.
Is that what you're going for, or is that too long? Is that too long to age it?
So if you're aging it to where you're saying it's almost like a second skin has
been produced
on the outside.
Exactly.
Okay. That's just dehydration. And that's just the outer layer of the muscle, that has been, that has dried down, because refrigerated environments are usually a relatively dry environment. Even though there may be water on the floor, it's still a relatively dry environment. So you're pulling moisture off the surface of that meat. And the longer you age, the more likely you're going to have to peel that stuff away. That's just the name of the game. We experience that in our leaner domestic livestock species too. So if we have a really lean bull that we harvested, doesn't have a lot of fat over the outside, that's just mm-hmm. how he is. If we hang it for a while, we may have to actually pull some of that dried material off the outside again. It's just part of the muscle, but it's a little dried on the outside. What's inside is muscle that has not been exposed to oxygen, and it's actually been protected by that kind of hardening casing on the outside that has naturally occurred. If you want to get into like the color, so on the outside of that muscle that is kind of dried down, it mm-hmm. started out as a bright cherry red color, and then it's kind of turned into a dark purplish, almost brownish green.
Yeah.
Different states of what we call myoglobin. Myoglobin is the red compound. It's the red pigment, the muscle protein that makes meat red.
Okay.
It's actually the oxygen binding compound in the meat. It has iron in it. And the reason that muscle turns red is it's a similar reaction to rust, essentially. And so that meat on the outside, like I said, started out bright cherry red when you put it into the meat bag, and then slowly turns to a kind of a darkish purplish brownish greenish color. We call that metmyoglobin. But when you cut into that again, it'll bloom to that bright cherry red color again. It's all the same muscle. To answer your question in a short sense, that outer layer is just dehydration if you've hung the carcass for 7 to 14 days. Not a bad idea to just go ahead and peel that off there for palatability purposes, for just overall eating experience. Yeah.
Okay. So that's going to lead, there is within the, now, by the way, listeners, there's going to be a test on some of these terms he's using, but at the end of this, but myoglobin is going to be
there.
There's a lot of discussion within the hunting community regarding hang times. And you know, you'll have some people that are like, you know, hang that thing overnight and then get it in the freezer, cut it up, get it in the freezer. There's other people that say, I always hang mine for 14 days. And there's a lot of various different circumstances too. Meaning, for example, my daughter's buck was shot on our property here in North Idaho. So my ability to get this meat cooled down and hung quickly is a lot different than the mule deer that I hunted where I was, you know, 5 or 6 hours from home, and further into the backcountry and getting it out. Right. And so I guess I'm throwing a lot at you here, but let's stick with just the simplicity of the question of what do you recommend hang time for wild game? And we're talking specifically deer and elk. And before I do that, Phil, is that a fair comparison? Like deer and elk meat?
Yeah.
Do you think that they're close enough in terms of what the type of meat is and all that?
Yeah. I mean, they're so similar. The species are so similar, and I would say it's a good comparison. there are so many variables. It's the reason why meat science is a discipline. I mean, we could say, okay, well, you harvested it in North Idaho, but maybe the mule deer could have been just right down the road. It's different species. Maybe it was eating something different. You know, so many different variables there. We can just really simplify this. And I believe I've read this in the past, and I know there's some research out there on tenderness and optimization of cervidae species, so deer type species. My understanding is still it's that seven to 14 days is going to be kind of your optimum range of aging. Now, if it's the animal that you shot on your property, got into the cooler real quick, because of the temperature slowing down the activity enzymes, that's one that I would actually recommend. If you can, hang it a little bit longer, 10, 14 days, you're okay. For the animal that you harvested in the backcountry and it's taking you a long time to get in, and maybe you're dealing with some warmer temperatures, warmer weather, you really don't need to age it long because the enzymes have been very active. So it's going to be pretty tender. But the other thing that happens at those high temperatures is the microbial community that's on the surface of that meat. As clean as you are with a knife, there's always going to be microbes. That's just how it is. That's what we live in. And usually lactic acid producing bacteria, these are the ones that kind of give you a tart, sour taste to things. And so they're going to be very active as well at higher temperatures. And so in those cases, if you are, say, that backcountry situation, warm temperatures, and you're just not able to cool that thing down, as soon as you can get that thing into the freezer, that would be my recommendation, is to do that. I wouldn't do a whole lot of aging on that one. But the ones, the porch hunters like I am, if I can't hunt with my slippers on, I don't know if I'm going to go too far out. For the porch hunters like I am, and I have access to a cooler and get that thing right away, I'm not going to even hesitate to age that a little bit longer, because of the quickness getting into the cooler, minimizing any of that microbial growth on the outside, and therefore minimizing spoilage. But then I also will need that extra time for the tenderness to occur.
Okay, so to the other side of that spectrum, where let's say we're talking to the porch hunters, because there's a lot of, I mean, this is America. A lot of us have land, and you'll brushing your teeth in the morning, a big buck walks out and onto the back lawn, and there you go. On that end of the spectrum, is there a downside to butchering and freezing too quickly? Say one morning, you get a buck down, and you essentially don't even bother hanging it. You get the hide off and go right to butcher.
Yeah.
Obviously letting it cool. Mm-hmm. And then getting it right to butcher, whether you're taking it in or you do it yourself. What do you say to that?
So that's a great question too. And this would honestly be a really good question, like as a final for my classes. And I may include it, in fact. So,
hey, cool.
I'll give you credit. Two things can happen there. Okay. For the extremely experienced and proficient and efficient butcher and hunter that, I mean, you got that thing skinned and dressed within 30 minutes of shooting it, and you potentially could have that meat into the freezer, in theory, by the end of the day.
Yeah,
that actually will make a very tough piece of meat. And I'm not going to get into the biochemistry of that, but you do want that carcass to go into rigor. And you guys are familiar with rigor. Rigor mortis.
Oh, yeah.
It's the stiffness of death. That is important, because if those muscle fibers are frozen or chilled too quickly prior to rigor, you get what's called cold shortening. And cold shortening is those muscles will actually super contract. If you think of muscle fibers, and I know listeners out there driving, you can't see my fingers, but I'm crossing my fingers over. Cold shortening is like my hands are gripped together super tight, and now you have to try to bite through that. Versus if my hands were just barely loosely connected, there's still going to be a contraction of death, rigor mortis. But it's not going to be as extreme as if you did put that meat into an extremely cold environment prior to rigor. That would be detrimental. But that's an extreme case, I would say.
Sure.
The in the contrast to that would be you know, you get it home, the buck's already, you know, legs are sticking straight out, things are good. You've gone into rigor. As long as it has gone into rigor, I do recommend a little bit of aging, but all circumstances you got to have to understand, you know, if it was a really warm conditions you hunted in and you didn't get it into refrigeration until a day or two after, or it was a gut shot, we have potential for spoilage. And so you may want to work that meat up a little quicker, and it's not going to be quite as detrimental. So,
okay.
If you're anything like me, you're always looking for ways to improve your elk hunting skills for September. And one of my favorite ways is the Elk Collective. It's an absolute game changer in self-education. This virtual elk hunting course has over 150 videos that cover everything from elk calling, strategy, tips, setup, gear, much, much more. There's a bunch of people involved. Some of the best elk hunters in the woods are involved with the Elk Collective, and they've come together to put together this virtual course to help you notch more tags in September. So check it out at theelkcollective.com and use promo code, all one word, the Western Huntsman, for $20 off the entire course. That makes the course only $69. It's a great deal. And I promise, if you go through this course, you will go into the elk woods with a lot more confidence and a much better chance at notching a tag on the mighty Wahoo. Hoffman Boots is the boot choice of the Western Huntsman podcast, and it has been for a very long time. I love my Hoffman in the Explorers, in the 6-inch or the 8-inch. They have all sorts of options for you to check out. Hoffman Boots is my go-to boot because I am a firm believer that when it comes to gear, the one piece of gear you don't want to skip on is boots. Get really good boots. And if you choose to do some Hoffman boots, you're going to find out why I highly recommend these hunting boots. Made by a multi-generational family of shoemakers, these boots are made right here in North Idaho, and I've got an excellent deal for you if you choose to go with Hoffman boots. Use promo code all caps lock Huntsman10 for 10% off. Get you some of these boots and find out why I love them. They're totally waterproof. They're going to give you great traction on the mountain. They're super comfortable. There's very little break-in period. Can't recommend Hoffman boots enough. Check it out, guys. Next on the list is Scree Gear, high-octane hunting attire without breaking the bank. You want to go into the field with good camo, right? You want camo that works, that'll keep you dry, that'll keep you comfortable. You want layering systems, the merino wool, the rain gear, all the things that make hunting a little bit easier and allows you to stay in the field a lot longer. The problem with most of it is it's super expensive, not with Scree Gear. Scree Gear will give you all the high-end technical gear that you want without having to take out a second mortgage, and that's why I like it. And to make it even better, got a promo code, the Western Huntsman, all one word, and that will give you 15% off and free shipping. It's a heck of a deal, guys. I recommend checking out like their bundle packages. They have like the elk bundle or the whitetail bundle or the turkey bundle. All those bundles come with multiple pieces of gear, and you won't regret getting this gear. It's great stuff. Check out Scree at ScreeGear.com. Oh, and you want to call in an elk? Use Phelps Game Calls. I've been using Phelps Game Calls since just about the beginning of Phelps Game Calls. It's a great company story, too. This company started in a little garage and is now one of the premier call companies on within the industry. I mean, you can't go wrong with Phelps Game Calls, whether it's turkey calls, predator calls, waterfowl, or especially I think the bread and butter is the elk calls. And I use the Maverick, I use the Pink, I use the Gray Amp. Check out the Amp series. If you're new to calling, I recommend getting a couple of different ones and trying them out. Find out which one works best for you. But I promise you, I'm not steering you wrong when it comes to Phelps Game Calls. It's a great company full of great people that make excellent products that actually work. And the proof is in the pudding. Call in a lot of elk, and you will too, if you trust me, by going to PhelpsGameCalls.com. I got a promo code for you, right? Huntsman10. Huntsman10 for 10% off your Phelps Game Calls, and check them out. Phelps Game Calls. Get them close. Two last items. Check out the Reveal Cell Cams from Tacticam, whether it is for hunting or security. These are excellent cell cams that I have all over my property. To include, I put them on some job sites for some security, so people I know if they're stealing materials or whatever, I'm going to catch them. And another little promo code I like to throw out there is for Baitem 907 for anybody that is hunting bears spring or fall and you are allowed to bait. Don't forget to go to Baitem907.com. Since made in Alaska, use promo code Huntsman10 for 10% off. The stuff works, and it works well. Let's get back to the show. Here we go.
No, this is great stuff, actually, and because you know why it's great is because you've heard, everybody that's hunted, they've heard, you know, the opinions on how long to hang it, how long to do this, how long to do that, and I think it's a pretty well known thing to most hunters to wait for rigor to set in. But the difference is it's not me saying it; it's actually a meat scientist, and I want to share with you. Something that we were talking about, Mike Edgehouse. He's down in Lewiston, there, just south of you there. He says, when I asked him about you, he said he has eaten wet aged beef that's 365 days old. Mm-hmm. Yep. What was that about?
It was great. You know, that, honestly, so this is for those who do enjoy domesticated livestock and do enjoy traditional meat from a grocery store or from a packer, that was a testament to just how clean the conditions are at the packing houses. What that means is that so we open the package, and first off, we're using our senses to kind of gauge, do I want to eat this?
Yeah.
But it'd been in refrigeration the entire time, under 40 degrees, well into the 30s. It did have a bit of a sourness smell to it, but it wasn't overpowering by any means. The meat was extremely tender, but nothing that was off-putting about it. And you okay. think, you know, there's a whole year of aging on this product. And I don't recommend it. But it also, again, it's a testament to just how clean the food system is in the United States, especially in the meat side of things, because the meat going into that bag was so clean that you didn't have spoilage organisms. You didn't have, I mean, you did, but they were so minuscule that it didn't result in an off-putting taste or sensory experience. But it was super tender.
Wow. I'll bet. Yeah, man. That's fantastic.
So, yep.
I have one more question on the rigor thing.
Yeah.
Is there, would you say, is there like a rule of thumb for there? We have a lot of new hunters on the show. Mm-hmm. And you know, sometimes I feel like, you know, if it's our first animal, mm-hmm. maybe not being able to recognize rigor.
Okay.
And like in a state as to which where you as a meat scientist at that point would feel good about butchering that animal, right? Mm-hmm. Is there like a rule of thumb of time after death for that to set in, or what do you say to something along those lines?
Yeah, most of our deer species, they would probably follow along similar lines of goats and sheep, mm-hmm. and even beef. And beef will settle in. So on the biggest animal that you could possibly shoot as far as game, moose or something like that, they're going to be similar to our large beef animals. Rigor will set in within about 12 hours.
Okay.
So you should be in pretty good shape that way. And, you know, I mean, the reality is by the time you hunt, shoot an animal, and especially if you're less experienced, you're probably not going to have that thing in the freezer within 12 hours.
Sure.
Maybe I could be wrong, but if you did want to just double check, you know, a great fail safe would just let it hang overnight. Rigor will set for sure by that time. The other thing too is rigor, just feel the legs. If you can't bend, like say that foreshank, or you can't bend the knee, the knee joint or anything, those muscles have set up. They are now in their full contracted death state. And so, rigor is set in that point.
Perfect. Perfect. I love it, man. I like taking, I love this real complicated information. Sometimes it could just be simplified, and it's like an art form when people can do that.
It's the only way I can understand things. So
yeah. I'm a few levels down from that, where I can't understand it. And when I try to explain it, I just complicate it more. And so that's just how I roll. So, practicability, I guess, wise, can we discuss our backcountry hunters and getting into, because what here it is, what is it, the 15th today, August 15th. So specific to Idaho and most Western states, September archery elk season is knocking on our door.
Yep.
It's coming. Which is what I look forward to all year. And this is my favorite season. Well, spring bear is kind of creeping up on that, but elk is still my number one favorite thing to do. And you're usually quite a ways from the truck.
Yeah.
When you find an elk or get your elk down, it's usually, you know, obviously it's September. So our temperatures are, we're not talking about November hunting here.
Yeah.
It's warmer. A lot of people that listen to this are hunting in pinyon pine country or sage country where it's a drier heat and less shade, less water.
Yeah.
I want people to be able to come out of this episode and be able to maybe identify with, you know, beyond a shadow of a doubt, when that meat has spoiled. And yeah. And does that make sense? Be able to look at that meat, be able to look at those muscles.
Yeah.
And make a call. Okay, this is not safe anymore. Yeah. Can you kind of walk us through that?
Well, I'll give you the very, very quick and short answer. The good Lord gave us our noses. And if you can't get it past your nose, that meat has spoiled. Okay, so that's the first step. If you're starting to see kind of a slippery, slimy substance starting to grow in and around any exposed muscle, there's a good chance that meat's starting to spoil. You're probably starting to get yeast colonies. You're probably starting to get a little bit of slime molds. You're probably getting what we call biofilms of spoilage organisms all over that. And so it's a multitude of things. We do have definitions for what spoilage is as far as bacterial contamination in the meat sciences. I'm not going to get into that because this is a very different situation. We need. What do you have at hand? And really, you know, follow your nose, follow your eyes, follow your gut instinct on this thing. The other thing, too, is especially for our backcountry folks, and I could be wrong, and I probably need to go consult some other of my colleagues who are more aggressive hunters than I, who, again, I'm a porch hunter. And so, for those in the backcountry, really just focus on field dress. Because we want to still the meat under that muscle, or excuse me, under that hide, it's essentially sterile. Okay, as long as you are able to, you know, minimize the damage from the actual shot, the wound, and contain that, leave that hide on until you do get into that refrigerated environment, so that you can now, once you expose that, now you have a colder temperature to minimize any of that contamination of the muscle itself. If it's a gut shot, be prepared to do some extensive trimming. Don't take the risk because, oh, I can get another half pound of hamburger here. No. Just don't bother with that. Okay. There will be another, but there's not another you. And so
yeah.
you don't want to get yourself into a spot where you're very, very ill. Be prepared to do some extensive trimming. But, you know, again, back to your original question, though, is spoilage is usually an indication of very high microbial load. Microbes will express themselves via odors as byproducts. You'll know it. You'll see the sliminess of it. You can trim some of that away if it's minimal, but if it starts to get, you know, throughout the entire carcass, don't take any risks. Don't take any chances, you know, just be smart about it. So
that,
I don't know if that answers your
question. No, it absolutely does. And I think you nailed it with, just explaining, like, the nose is going to tell most, you know, the full story. However, I have some buddies that have had, COVID and they still don't have a sense of smell.
Oh,
so they're in trouble. Thanks.
Okay.
No. Yeah. So I think that's what I was thinking about.
Not to laugh at that. I mean, it's serious, but yeah.
I know. It's crazy. They got one buddy who says it's slowly coming back, and another buddy that he said, nope, can't smell anything. And it was like almost a year ago.
And that's crazy. Where have make friends with someone who does have their sense of
smell. Yeah. Take somebody that has a sense of smell. Yeah. So let's kind of paint a picture. Just I guess meat care, right? Mm-hmm. What does getting dirt due to the meat, on the meat, due to the meat. Did I ask that right? That sounded sure. weird, didn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. Dirt, contaminant, hairs, all mm-hmm. that stuff are going to speed the spoilage process. Dirt is, it's interesting how nature has designed us to recognize that on food and say, ah, I don't want to eat that. Mm-hmm. And what I would say is with any contaminant that's on there that you don't either know exactly what it is or would rather not see it on there, cut it away. Okay. And the reason I say that is because you mentioned water and some folks, yeah, that, you know, you get a little contaminants on there when you're dressing the carcass, you're pulling the hide off and everything. And, we'll get this. We'll just hit it with the hose.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what Guilty. You're doing. Yeah. And the hose is a great, especially a cold garden hose is great for cooling that carcass down very quickly. That water will transfer heat very well. Do that after you have trimmed away every visual contaminant you could see. And the reason I say that is because if there is some dirt or manure or gut contaminant on there and you spray it with a hose, you've essentially now just inoculated the rest of that carcass. You've spread it.
Gotcha.
Even though you can't see it, that's why we call them microorganisms, because we can't see them, but they're there. And so anytime you do have some contaminant on there, what we do in the meat sciences and the reason that we can have product at times reach 365 days at refrigerated temperature is because we do trim away. We don't just wash away.
So, okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Which leads to another, I feel like I'm just doing like this lightning round of questions at you, but
oh, I love it.
This is great stuff. This is great stuff. All right. Scenario, you've shot a deer. Deer's on the ground. You're going to gut it. You hit that bladder bag and urine sprays out everywhere. Yeah. What do we do with that meat? Is it cut away? Is it throw away? Is it salvageable, washable?
I wouldn't bother trying to salvage it. So as far as food safety is concerned, if you can get it past your nose and your mouth, you can you'll eat it and you'll be fine. Mm-hmm. So your buddies that have COVID and no sense of smell, maybe they'll be just fine with something like that. So from a sense of food safety, it's not that big of a deal. It is a food quality issue. And the reason I bring this up is and the scenario that I would give you is domesticated boars. So we have boars in the pig industry, and the reality is those things can get a taint kind of like that the bladder on a deer.
Mm-hmm.
That it's not as a food safety issue, but a USDA inspector can condemn the carcass because it's just so rank and it's not worthy of going into the food chain. In your case, in the case of the deer and the bladder bag, cut it away. Cut it down and use your nose or use your buddy's nose to see, did I get this thing out? Did I clean it enough? Be liberal with cutting it. Don't be afraid of doing that. It's for your sake and it's for the sake of the deer too. You took the deer's life. It's your responsibility to do the right thing. Eat as much of it as you can, use as much as you can, but say you only barely trim a little bit away trying to save as much as you can.
Mm-hmm.
And now you start cooking. And so now you've got this, you know, a big leg steak or something there. And you're like, what is that awful stench? Well, it's because you left some contaminant on there. And now you could have cut away maybe an eighth of a pound. Now you're mm-hmm. throwing away a whole pound of meat. And so if you think about it, it's a way to save more meat by just being liberal with the knife and cutting away anything that may have been contaminated by it. I would say, okay. You know, you should be able to salvage something.
Yeah.
That would be my guess. Yeah.
Do you have an opinion on game bags, types of bags to store that meat? Yeah. I don't know if you have a ton of experience with different type, like, you know, I kind of geek out with game bags.
Yeah. Well,
and I wasn't happy with my last one. So,
let's flip the interview around and I'll ask you. No, I don't have very much experience with that. If we had our meat lab manager on here, James Nasato's here at the University of Idaho, he runs our Vandal Brand Meats. He's very well versed in the animal fabrication or game fabrication and hunting and such. And so we can question him and he'd probably be a great guest for you in the future.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. Yeah. I'd love to do it. So yeah. I just kind of let's logistically, again, going back to some of us elk hunters that are going to be, you know, 4 or 5 miles from the truck or in the backcountry or whatever, it's going to take us multiple trips, right?
Yep.
Possibly 2 days to get these animals out. Mm-hmm. Luckily in North Idaho, these big, beautiful coniferous, you know, dark timber forests that we have,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
We can usually find some water and shade to hang the meat in.
Perfect.
The folks that are down in like the pinyon pine country or some of the drier climates, and that don't have, you know, a drainage with a little creek in the bottom of it everywhere, every time you turn around.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's not like I don't know the answer to that, but I keep going back to a circumstance that I've been in where I felt the meat got too hot It's not that I could smell anything or visually see any spoilage or anything. But when the meat cools off and then the temperature rises again, does that damage flavor? Does it make sense how I'm asking that?
Yeah. So if you have those big swings in temperature fluctuation, especially, you know, fall in North Idaho, you could have a 85 degree day and a 45 degree night.
Oh, absolutely.
It's honestly, it's a bit of a blessing. Those cold evenings are going to really help chill that carcass down, and not to an extreme case like we talked about earlier. The warmer temperatures, if you do have an ability to use some type of game bag that's not going to saturate that carcass and put it in a stream, it's probably a really good idea if you can do that during the daytime when the temperatures are really warm.
So in the game bag, maybe put it in like a contractor plastic garbage sack and then.
I've done that.
Yeah, I've done it. And but I've also made the mistake of taking that same contractor bag and putting a quarter in my regular fridge at home. And without any allowing it to air out, man, that meat, you were talking about that slimy, kind of finish on the surface. Yeah. Very quick. Super. Yeah. I lost a lot of meat on that. Bad mistake.
So let's talk about that just a little bit because,
if
you're in the backcountry and you're it's going to take you a couple days to get that elk out. You are kind of more in survival mode versus porch hunting and a fridge. You're in comfort mode. Survival mode, use the bag, put it into the creek, cool that thing down. Even if the creek is 60 something degrees, it's still cooler than the ambient air, say in early fall where you're in the 70s and 80s. And so the cooler it is, the better it's going to be in that regard for spoilage, prevention of spoilage. If it's a porch hunter like myself and you got the animal, you can get into the cooler, but don't put any surface that's going to really just tack right to the meat and essentially create an anaerobic environment, because what's happening now is you are allowing for certain spoilage organisms that like anaerobic environments, such as the lactic acid bacteria, to thrive. And now you're going to have some of that kind of sticky tackiness on the outside. It's going to be very sour. You can smell the sourness usually when you open the bag. And so in those cases, I would probably recommend, you know, if you have some tubs or something that has a lid, put the pieces in and around that. Okay. Or in and on that. You can put some kind of covering over it. If you have some old bed sheets or bed sheets from people that you don't like, put those on there and, you know, that's going to kind of, slow the migration of the evaporation of the meat. So you don't necessarily have to skin it yet again. But it's going to keep you from getting that kind of sliminess on there.
So I think so. You cut out just a second or for a minute there. You're talking about putting the meat inside like those plastic tubs you get from Home Depot or something thing.
Yep.
With the lids on it.
Yep.
Does it need any kind of ventilation?
No. So it's not going to be a very super sealed environment. And so that's the idea, is that it's still going to be more aerobic. spoilage organisms are there. They're going to be doing their thing,
sure.
But it's not going to be quite as isolated as our anaerobic lactic acid producing bacteria that are going to indicate spoilage relatively quickly if you give them the right conditions. And that's you wrap it in a contractor's bag and put it in your fridge for a few days. The contractor's bag is probably really good for that survival situation where
in the backcountry. Yeah.
Backcountry. And we're going to keep it cold as best as we can, but get it out of that bag just to let some of that evaporation occur, because it's going to enhance the overall product eventually. So
awesome.
Yeah.
Okay, I know we're knocking on an hour's door here. It's what happens when you're having fun, man.
Exactly.
Right? Going to the next step. So, I'll just give you a scenario. Going through my freezer, which is specific for my wild game meat, right? Mm-hmm. Digging through it, kind of seeing what's in there, taking a inventory, whatever. Come across a package that says Deer Loins 2019. Here it is, 2022.
Sure.
Garbage? Good. What do you think? I mean, it's all freezer sealed, but
it's all freezer. And so, okay, a couple things. A lot of guys, folks, not just guys, folks like to use freezer paper because it's cheap. And you don't have to have the added equipment of a vacuum packager and such. I would say you have about a year in the freezer, as long as you can really get really good at and proficient at wrapping that stuff nice and tight. You have about a year before you're going to run into flavor changes. Perfectly safe still. If as long as your freezer hasn't broken down, you'll be fine. It's just you're going to start getting what's called oxidation. So a little bit of a rancidity of the meat.
Okay.
So after about a year, I would recommend let's rotate through that product. If for some reason, you got the deep freeze at home, you keep it nice and stocked, and all of a sudden you finally decided to dig to the bottom, see what's there, and you get that 3-year-old steak that's sitting there. If it was paper wrapped, again, you're going to be fine food safety-wise. Flavor-wise, it may not be all that great. You're probably going to have some freezer burn on there because you're not going to avoid that with paper wrap.
So make some dog treats out of that one.
Yeah, and make great dog treats, or feed it to friends you don't like or something like that, you know.
My mother-in-law,
my recommendation, and I love my mother-in-law, she's out there listening. My recommendation would be if you're going to be a hunter, regular hunter, make the investment in a vacuum sealer. It is by far the most effective way of maintaining meat quality, especially under frozen conditions. And so, that 3-year-old steak, if it's still in a sealed vacuum pouch, and it's been frozen the whole time, you may notice a subtle change in the flavor, but it will not be drastic. It won't be like the paper wrapped product. And in both cases, it should be safe to eat.
That's interesting. I just want to kind of like second what you just said there. Guys, if you're listening, the good doctor just mentioned, just make the investment in a freezer sealer. They're actually super inexpensive.
Yeah.
Unless you're somebody who's just going to hopefully get a deer or something every few years or whatever, you need to get one. Because what you were just saying there, you know, the difference between 1 year and 3 years or some of the flavor changes or whatever. I noticed when I started using a freezer sealer, when I say I use them, I don't even know how to turn it on. I cut the meat and then my wife freezer seals it. So she knows what she's doing.
Sure.
But I notice even after like 3 months, when you compare that to like a paper wrapped package of meat, for us, and maybe it was just a coincidental thing, but we're like, man, this tastes better. It like maintains the flavor it traps it in, or I don't know what it does, but this was 3 years ago. We've never gone back to the paper wrap. So I couldn't agree with that more.
Yeah. We pretty much exclusively, except for some really weird cuts, like ribs, ribs are kind of hard to vacuum seal, especially because the bones will poke through and everything. I'll still paper up those, just eat them quicker, you know, just know where they are and eat them sooner. But yeah, we pretty much almost exclusively use vacuum pouches. We cut our own beef at home as well, and so we'll do the same thing. But for deer, any type of game, that's my recommendation. And for those who may think, you know, well, they're really expensive, you got to go beyond the retail store. And there's some really great websites out there that cater to restaurants that can get you the vacuum pouches at a significantly lower cost, as long as you purchase the ones that are for external sealers. That's the home type vacuum sealer. You can get those at a fraction of the cost that you would buy at a retail outlet.
Man, that is a hot tip. Yeah. So okay, yeah, that was worth having you on just for that. I'm pretty excited to check that out. That's awesome, because they do charge an arm and a leg at the retail shops for those. So
it's kind of like printer ink, you know, they'll give you the printer, but they'll the ink
right
three times the cost. So
yeah, for sure. Well, let's wrap this up, Phil. With do you have, as a meat scientist, what is your favorite cut off of a deer, and how do you prepare it?
It depends. It kind of depends. It's kind of like picking your favorite child, right? You know, the backstrap's fantastic, and everybody's kind of, it's a go-to. It's a great go-to.
Sure.
You know, it's the longissimus muscle for those who really want to nerd out on the scientific side of things. It's the same thing as the ribeye and the strip loin in a beef animal. And for a direct heat grilling situation, that's fantastic. I have a friend, however, that makes some unbelievable deer shoulder chimichangas, and I wouldn't use a backstrap for something like that. It just depends on the application. And then if you're looking at some whole muscle jerky, that hind leg is going to be perfect for it, because you can seam those pieces out. And guys, don't make the mistake of trying to get a little bit more jerky by just leaving that silver skin on. Take that outer connective tissue off. If it looks silvery, take it off, because it's going to be so chewy, you're going to be flossing with it. And so I didn't answer your question, and I refuse to. It's kind of like, yeah,
that's
what's
okay.
Your favorite beer?
Yeah. Yeah. It depends. If you're on a tropical beach in Mexico, it's going to be a Corona or something.
It's going to be a Corona. Yeah.
North Idaho, man, it's probably a Coors Light, you know? Yeah. No, I hear you on that. That's interesting what you said about the silver skin. Because when I'm butchering myself, I take it off when I'm making jerky.
Yep.
But if I'm doing steaks or burger, I generally leave it on.
And you'll be fine.
Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay.
Absolutely. Because you're going to take it to a temperature that's going to take that's going to break that silver skin down. That's connective tissue.
Yeah.
It's collagen. Think of a brisket. You know, brisket actually, if anybody's out there has smoked a whole brisket before, that actually has a lot of silver skin type connective tissue interwoven throughout the muscle. So if you just tried eating a rare brisket steak, which nobody would do, it's going to be super chewy. But if you cook it for a longer period of time, you're going to break that stuff down. And then on top of that, for the burger, I know this is going to sound a little gross, but the grinder is effectively pre-chewing it for you. Okay, so you're taking the tougher meat, you're breaking it down into smaller particle sizes. So it's always tender that way. And so you shouldn't have the big problems. Now, I'm not saying drop a whole Achilles tendon in there too and hope for the best. But, you know, minimize that kind of stuff. But what I usually do is it's mostly on the beef carcasses, but I will over trim that silver and connective tissue, get down to the muscles that you want for making jerky or whatever whole muscle item you want. Take that stuff that does have that silver skin and connective tissue, run it through the grinder, mix in some beef fat or pork fat or whatever your preference is to increase the fat content. And it'll be fantastic. And you're going to improve your yields that way. Get that silver skin away if you're making jerky, because it's not palatable. It's not fun when you bite into that thing. So.
That's the kind of that's like when you're at the gas station, you buy the cheapest beef jerky on the shelf, and it takes you 2 hours to chew one bite. yeah. and your jaw hurts. I think that's what they're doing, you know? So, well, Phil, this was a really great conversation. I'd love to have you on again at some point when we could maybe talk about some more, you know, a little more deeper, on the meat topic, because I think it's always interesting, man, when, you know, we'll do episodes about, you know, how to archery hunt for elk, or some of the politics involved in hunting, or, you know, all these different things. But the meat topics and meat care and meat processing. And I've got some good buddies that are butchers. And then there's a lot of us that butcher our own. And it's just this, it's always a very a lot of interest every time we talk about this topic.
Yeah.
So, it's good to get an actual expert on that, you know, has that kind of background, and, really good to have you on. So I appreciate that.
Yeah. Likewise. Thank
yeah.
you.
yeah. So I want to encourage folks to check out your podcast, MeatsPad. And guys, what I'll do is I'll put that in the show notes, and, you guys, check it out. It's awesome. This is great stuff you're doing. I appreciate what you're doing. I feel like that's it's like such a great topic to have in the youth out there to learn the benefits of things like beef and meat and all these things, and how it ties together with just a basic humanity in general. You know, it's we can get real philosophical with it if we want. And so appreciate what you do. And thanks for coming on.
Absolutely. I appreciate the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you.
You made it all the way to the end. Thank you so much for tuning into the show. We sure appreciate your support. This is Jim Huntsman signing off and reminding you to check us out at Instagram at The Western Huntsman and on Facebook at The Western Huntsman. And you can also check out the website at thewesternhuntsman.com. Thanks again. We'll see you guys next time. Stay Western, and I'll see you on the mountain.